We have made some major user interface improvements to functional testing. Let's have a look. This list shows the things that we have improved, and let us look at them in a live demo. Let us start looking at the palette, which has had some really good improvements. First of all, a really desired thing is that the palette can now scroll. So you, if you have not a too big screen, you can actually scroll the palette elements. The names of the elements have also been giving better names, so it's easier to understand what they can do. And there's a tooltip on each of the elements, so you can actually understand what they can do. And finally, there's a filter, so if you want to do something with, for instance, data sets, you can just start to write and it will filter and show you the elements that are relevant for the thing that you want to do. That's the palette. Let's look at some of the improvements to different elements on the palette. So first of all, let's look at SQL select. You can see the name is now SQL space select. So that is just one of the small improvements to the palette. And for the SQL select, we have also changed it. So the SQL select statement now is presented in a text area instead of just a single line text field. So you can now make larger select statements and have the SQL select statement in multiple rows. Another thing is all the dialogues has been improved to align with how CompuWare UIs looks like and how the unit test looks like. That means the labels have been arranged to be left-centered and have colons after them, smaller changes. Another thing is, if we look at the functional test element, it now reminds more about how the unit test looks like in a user experience. So we have the data structure, input-output data. We can still choose between list and tree, but there were some additional tabs with a table view and source view that were not really used. So we have aligned this and made it simpler. So just show what users need. And we have put other properties into tabs. So you can focus either on the linkage section structure. You can go to properties to see some additional things, which is execution properties and labels and ID and so on. And you have other tabs as well, where you can set up, for instance, DD statements, datasets, and so on. So that was the functional test. Then another improvement we have made is if you double click on an element, it will actually show a pop-up where you can start to make the same changes. And before there were a number of annoying things, like we had a cancel button that didn't work. And if you made a change, for instance, if you created a label change, it would not be reflected after you closed the editor. But now you can see it is saying one here, and on the properties, you also see the label has changed. Small changes, but it has been an annoying box that has now been removed. Now, let us look at how we have improved the result editor for functional testing. So here we have another example of a test scenario that contains three steps. First, a functional test, where we have set it up to actually have an expected value that will be invalid. And we also set it up to verify program exit code that we know it will not return. So this step will produce two errors. Next step will just be reading a spool file from the latest executed job. And the last one is to select a couple of rows from a table in DB2. So let us see how that result report looks like. So this has been completely redesigned. So the overview page now shows assertion failures. And for this test scenario, it contains two failures. First one is that the program exit code was not verified to be acceptable. And if I select the assertion, we can see the assertion type. We can see it's a failure, and we can see the assertion details, that the program exit code was not verified to be equal 12. Next one is a field assertion, where we can see that The failure was that the risk factor was expected to be 23, but the actual value was 22. And something new here is also that assertion of expected values that are not equal to the actual value will be colored red, and expected values that are equal the actual value will be colored green, and values that are not asserted on will just be in black. So that's the overview, focusing on assertions like unit test is doing. And then we have a detailed view where we can see all the steps in the test scenario that produce data. They also have a specific UI. So the SQL select statement, we can see that it returned two rows and it has the columns with ID and first name. The spool file, we can see the content of the spool file. So it has a dedicated view to show that. And the functional test has the same view as for the assertion, where we can actually see the input output data and we can see some more details up on top. So these are great improvements to how the result report looks like. We have also made an improvement to the web browser when you want to create a test case where you want to use a custom accounting info. It can now be possible. So here I am at the execution page for a program, and if I hit the option button, here I can write in a custom accounting info that should be used as part of the job card. So I can execute this. I can also save all the data here as a test case, and this is what is new. So if I save this as a demo accounting, I save it as a test scenario, I create a new one, then it will create a new test scenario in my test scenario part of the repository. So if I go and find that demo accounting and I select it, we can now see that it has the optional accounting info element right here. And now I can execute the test scenario and it will use this accounting info in execution of the test case. This is something new that can now be used in this release. Last thing we would like to demonstrate is a new feature where we can verify that a redefined DFHCom area for a Kix application or a Kix program is the same length as the original element. So here we have a CICS component, and I can analyze the source code on the mainframe and extract the linkage section. So this will return the one field or one structure, the DFHCom area. And let's say that I want to redefine all these fields. And now I'll do a redefine that is wrong. So I'll go in and change a field here that we say instead of 4 bytes, it's 8 bytes. And then I will try to update. And what has happened is when I analyze the code, it will calculate the length of the DFHCom area. It will set the argument length in the source parameter. And when I now update with my redefined structure, it will verify that length against the length that I just retrieved. And it should say, well, the expected length is 508 and my or 80. And the actual length is 602. So we have 4 bytes too much. So then I have to go in and find what is the problem. And then I can redefine until it is correct again. So that is to avoid users setting up wrong DFHCom areas, meaning that they can risk to make storage violation in CICS.